3 мая 2002 года. Колину Макмиллану. 12 Парк-авеню.
To Colin Macmillan, May 3rd, 2002, Park Avenue 12, London, England. Hello, Colin, my dear, dear friend. I'm sorry I haven't written to you for such a long time. I was waiting for a proper occasion like this 60th anniversary of the arrival of the Allied convoy dervish in Arkhangelsk. Of course, this was a major date for us, but realizing all the hardships of modern life, our veterans had not even hoped for a celebration, but it did happen in spite of all.
Особенно я волновался, когда смотрел и слушал в зале Александринского театра оперу-балет «Реквием».
The most exciting part of it for me was the opera ballet «Requiem for Convoy PQ-17», performed by Canadian actors, the Symphony Orchestra Congress Hall and the choir of the Мусоргский опера and ballet theater. Can you imagine, Colin, that both the composer Christopher Butterfield and director, the leading dancer Bill Coleman, are children of the participants of polar convoys? Joseph's father, Bill, has twice been on a sinking ship, once while in PQ-17. Together with the other crewmates who had managed to survive, he'd been several days on a raft out in the sea when an English trawler took him on board and to hospital in Murmansk. This performance carried a patriotic message to the young, which said, look, these are your fathers and grandfathers. They were the people who defended the peace and stood up against those who threatened to destroy it. Be worthy of them. I can still remember when I was a boy the oppressive, creeping pace of time and how it speeded up as I got older. Now I'm in my 70s and you know it's just slipping away. The memories of that war cannot fade. They're splendidly vivid, as if those past 60 years had been no more than a dream. But there is something that reminds us of this long period. It's our friends and relatives and war comrades passing away. At the end of this year, 18 our friends are no longer with us, and ours is still the largest organization among the Russian Polar Convoy Veteran Committees. So we wanted to prepare something absolutely special for this anniversary, to cheer up our old guard and to give them a chance to see each other again. Because this is how we managed to survive all those years, by helping each other out, by not forgetting. And this was a hard thing to do, I can tell you. All through the Cold War, which separated our countries for the last 45 years, there was almost no note of the polar convoys in the works and publications on the Great Patriotic War, and what little was said reduced to almost nothing the immense role of the Allied aid. It just didn't fit into official policy for us to be friends. The only aim of this policy was to set us apart. Luckily, it was never to be realized. I think we must remember every person and every episode of those events, and this was what the laying of wreaths on water from the icebreaker on one of the days of the holiday was all about. Indeed, those were polar convoys, and icebreakers were absolutely essential to us in those circumstances. One of the legendary icebreakers of that time was Krasin. The younger brother of the famous Yermak, it had been the world's most powerful icebreaker for 35 years. It was constructed in 1917, according to the project of the well-known Admiral Makarov in the Armstrong Dockyard in Newcastle, and its original name was Svetogor. In 1922, it arrived in Petrograd and was used on the Baltic Sea until in 1927, when it was renamed Krasin. In 1928, this icebreaker saved Nobilis expedition. An Italian airship heading for the North Pole survived a severe crash. 6 countries sent 18 ships and 21 airplanes to the disaster spot. Krasin also took part in it, and on the way back it took on board 1,600 passengers from the sinking German steamboat Monte Cervantes. It is also the only icebreaker in the world that has sailed round the Earth. In May 1942, together with the other PQ-15 ships, it arrived in Murmansk. During this journey, it shot down 2 of the 5 fascist planes brought down by the convoy. In 1990, Krasin took its last tour of honor around the main ports of Europe. In May 1995, the first exhibition was opened on board, and it was turned into a history museum. It also served as a club where polar convoy veterans of the icebreaker and merchant fleets often met.
Именно дружба английских, американских моряков, а мы были как братья.
We were like brothers with the American and English sailors. We helped them and they helped us. We saved each other out in the sea, and this was what the outcome of those horrible battles on the Northern Fleet actually depended upon.
Почему венки будут опущены в воду завтра с борта Красноярска?
Why will the wreaths be laid on water tomorrow from Krasnysport?
Участвовавших в Великой Отечественной войне и в частности в полярных конвоях.
The reason is that of all the ships and vessels which took part in the war and in the polar convoys, Krasin is the only one that has remained intact in unworking condition.
Уважаемые офицеры, уважаемые друзья, уважаемые ветераны, я имею огромную честь быть здесь и
Dear officers, dear friends, dear veterans, it is a great privilege for me to be here and to express to you my personal gratitude and the gratitude of the British people. Thank you.
Я скажу, дорогие друзья, то, что тут произошло 60 лет назад, мне трудно поверить.
Let me tell you, my dear friends, that those were really dreadful events which took place here 60 years ago, and we all lost many of our friends and comrades then, and now I would like to salute all the participants who have gathered here today. Thank you. Reef on Water. During the celebration of Dervish, the icebreaker seemed to grow young again and to enjoy the anniversary with the veterans. It seemed more a reverent participant than a meeting place. The sort of his difficult life came to his mind again, and he remembered the people whose lives were tied up with his. Many captains have stood on its bridge, peering onto the cold icy expanses ahead, but today we would like to remember the last one. It's hard to believe that this smart, slim sailor is actually in his 90s now, but it's true, as well as the fact that Lev Yurievich Burak was captain of Krasin for more than 10 years running. He had fought in the Great Patriotic War and then followed his long marine career which led him to Krasin's bridge. His decency and professionalism ensured everybody that as long as Burak is on the bridge, everything will be fine with Krasin. Today Lev Yurievich is no longer with us, and the film shot on board the ship was his last one. We gathered today on board Krasin, which participated in the polar convoys of World War II, and first of all, we would like to remember those who perished in the battles. We are happy about those who survived and joined our holiday. We are very glad to welcome you on board the legendary ship and grateful to those who helped make this occasion possible.
Который уже стал достопримечательностью нашего города. Что будет с ним дальше?
The icebreaker Krasin has become one of the central attractions of the city. But its future is now a great concern for everybody, especially for us veterans. I know you're a keen lover of the arts, Colin, and I believe that if you had seen that requiem with your own eyes, it would have impressed you just as much. This was really a day worth living for. And there couldn't have been a better place for such an event than St. Petersburg, the marine capital of Russia. I don't think you realize how difficult it was to organize all that, and on an extremely small budget, by the way. But for my experience as a captain, I would have hardly managed it.
Мировая премьера Мы думали, что на нее прибудут, ну, конечно же, наш президент.
A world premiere, that's what we planned. We had expected that the Russian and American presidents, the British queen would all be our guests.
Хоть мы их и приглашали.
Well, no presidents or queens arrived in the end, but this didn't matter either, because the gratefulness we saw in the eyes of the veterans was our best reward. A lot of effort had been spent to make this dream a reality, but the people for whom it was done deserved 10 times as much, really. By the way, you know many of them. All through the war, Colonel Гусев and Mayor Levinson served as pilots in the Northern Fleet. Our regiment was named after Сафонов, who was twice hero of the Soviet Union, and our task was to протect the convoys on the approaches to Мурманск and Архангельск. It was then in 1942 that Сафонов ordered that Гусев prepare 5 sergeants who had graduated from Йейск Flying School for combat actions. Алексей Сергеевич did a brilliant job of this, which was proved later when all 5 pilots became heroes of the Soviet Union. My first reconnaissance mission was to spot the iceberg crossing, which I did and reported over the radio. Mayor Левинсон was in command of the parachute landing rescue service of the same regiment. He actually made 330 parachute jumps under the most difficult circumstances. His crew sank a transport with a displacement of 9,000 tons in January 1943 and an enemy mail boat in April that same year. The torpedo regiment was then the main aviation unit. Its pilots were even called kamikazes. Here I have the sign of the 9th Guards Regiment.
Дорогой Коля, за то время, что ты побывал в России, многих, наверное, уже узнаешь в лицо.
Many of those people you know personally, for example, Rear Admiral Peterson. In 1941-42 he defended Leningrad, and in 1945 participated in campaigns on the destroyers Доблестный and Дерзкий as part of the Northern Fleet operations. After the war, he remained in the Navy for a long time, employed on crucial posts. Beside him is Mikhail Georgievich Gavrilov. He was another link of the armor, of that very convoy which guarded the supply artery. Only thanks to such people did the aid channel keep functioning. Mikhail Georgievich was petty officer of a destroyer engine crew and took part in 15 convoys.
А крайне слева Валентин Дремлюк.
In the first row on the left is Valentin Dremluk, assistant commander of the hydrogeographic vessel Мурманец. A book or a film could certainly be written about his life, just like everybody else's here. I will only mention to you that the Secretary of Defense of the USA presented him with a memorial diploma for saving the lives of 147 English and American sailors. And here is Mikhail Anatolievich Авазбакиев. In 1938, at the age of 20, he became a member of the crew of the sailing ship Equator. At the beginning of the war, he was already navigator of the destroyer Стремительный in the Northern Fleet, and in 1944 he served in the Pacific Fleet as navigator of the heavy monitor Сиваш, fighting in the war against the Germans and the Japanese. Transferred to the reserves after the war had ended, he still couldn't part with the sea. He sailed on fishing boats and led ships along the Northern Sea route. Not long ago, Mikhail Anatolievich died, and it is an irreplaceable loss to us all. You know, Colin, time is merciless, and we cannot prevent people from dying, but we must not forget them as long as they live and need our support and attention. We must always remember what kind of enemy they managed to stop, turn back and overcome, and what were the costs of their victory. The most important qualities of the polar sailors were dedication and mutual support, and nowhere were these features of the Russian soldier of World War II so fully revealed as on the polar routes. Each of our veterans' lives can make a fascinating novel with their unique and heroic fates. But their deeds were not always rewarded, and even when they were, sometimes it was too late. Thinking back on the splendid Requiem performance, I'm turning the problem of fathers and sons' relationships over in my mind. You know well that respect to parents has become all too rare today. And this was really a noble gesture of the younger generation to put on such a glorious show. I believe that this holiday is a considerable investment in the future, a step towards a greater understanding between people, a step in the direction of peace and away from war. We survived the horrors and the atrocities of the war, and we want our children to safeguard the peace for which we fought so hard, while our duty will be to preserve all our knowledge and memories and share them with others. From time to time I feel a great yearning to be sure again, like I was in 1941, that we're not alone face to face with the enemy, that it won't take long for the reinforcements to reach us, and that they will arrive on time, like the first Allied convoy Dervish did 60 years ago, and many more after it. Lorries, mines, rubber and planes are all very important. Indeed, those arms and strategic resources were a blessing for us at the time, but the moral support that the convoys gave us was nonetheless crucial. You remember how much it lifted our spirits and what a devastating effect it had on the Germans when English and American machinery appeared on the fields. You know, Colin, the mission of the polar convoys is not yet through. We have to prevent the achievements of the 40s from neglect and oblivion. I think we need to put together an appeal for a universal veterans brotherhood, and you can already count on my signature to represent the will of Russians. In the House of Friendship, an international conference was held at which the Russian and English veterans were present. The atmosphere of the meeting was incredibly warm, and the memories of the past were revived together with the songs of those times. Since the end of the war, an English sailor, Bill Lowes, has been looking for a Russian woman, Zinaida Kuznetsova. They met in Murmansk and fell in love. Soon in 1943 they were separated by war. Since then Bill has been looking for Zinaida and her daughter Lubov.
Я также очень переживал за марш ветеранов полярных конвоев.
Of course, I was also very nervous about the march of the polar convoys held for the first time in our country. But at first a service was held for those who had perished in the convoys. The service has an unfailing, soothing and reassuring effect whenever you attend it. It makes you feel relaxed and at peace with the world. And still I was feeling somewhat uneasy. But when I approached the meeting and saw a lot of smartly dressed, excited, happy people, I immediately started to feel better. I was thinking whether 60 years was really an advanced age. Indeed, two generations are already an era, and the heroes of the war are already grand and great-grandfathers, but when they meet, the same faith in wartime friendship can be seen in their eyes. There is no doubt that at the beginning of the war with Russia, Germany had the best-equipped army, which had the industry of the whole Western Europe at its disposal. But World War II was not waged by machinery, it was waged by people, and they had won, regardless of all the rules of logic. Heaven only knows what they have stood, cold and hunger and the constant danger of attacks by planes, submarines and the fascist battleship Tirpitz, the most powerful ship of that time. Even the nature was against them. So tell me, what is the limit to human abilities? And I understood that such marches are to be held as long as the veterans are still alive. You see, Colin, under the inspiration of their father's heroism, the children created a fantastic requiem. It was full of respect and admiration for their historic deeds and for their lives. In fact, such a wonderful event is only a result of the great work that the Canadian government has been doing to raise and maintain the noble memory in the hearts of their young citizens. The deference and attention paid to veterans is immense in this country, and there isn't a shred of formality in their attitude. I could see it all for myself on November the 18th in the small town of Victoria on Vancouver Island, where I came on a special invitation from the Canadians to join the celebration of the Veterans Memorial Day. There, everyone understands that a veteran's life was spared not only for his own interests, but for the sake of his countrymen, for which he deserves a lot of care and attention, and all the more so if he has risked his life fighting for the independence of his motherland. So this is a holiday devoted entirely to the veterans. In Russia, it can only be compared to the solemn Victory Day celebration. I was just going to send off the letter when great news came that the icebreaker crossing has become member of the International Association of World Historic Ships. There are only 90 of them. On the 9th of May, the Consul General of the United States of America, in the presence of the Consuls General of Great Britain and Canada, the City Administration and the veterans, presented the ship crew with the medal and certificate of the association. I'm certainly very glad about this. At the same time, I'm really sorry that we don't have such friendly relations with the American veterans as we have with the Canadians and the English. It is even more regrettable if we consider the role of the United States in the Lend-Lease deliveries to Russia. You know, Colin, I have a dream that I would like to share with you. I dream of a universal Veterans Day to which the people from the whole world would come. Every year we would meet on this day and remember what we once managed to do to prevent the world from self-destruction. And we would also think of what we can try to do now to prevent it from ignorance.